right, let's start with turn one of reds. Should note that I'm using a few optional rules here. I will point those out here. Let's see if I can get them into the camera angle. Yeah, optional rules. So I won't be using 21.4 because I feel like the reds already have, or at least my level of play gives the reds already pretty good advantages. So I'm not going to let them just get leaders in quicker than they normally would. Leaders are, of course, how you get more chits automatically for different fronts. So allowing them to get their leaders when they roll events they can't normally use, it gives them a huge advantage. The other three I found in my previous plays really helps give the whites more longevity, or at least lets them sustain my idiocy longer. And so what they are is we're going to take three infantry divisions of the armed forces of South Russia. They're going to start up, set up rallied instead of disrupted. The whites will get the first two chit pulls. They actually get to decide what they want to do, so that's pretty good on turn one. And there are no replacements on turn strategic turn A. So I sort of stumbled over this in the introduction, but the way that the sort of sequence of play runs is that we'll have operational turns, these are the numbered turns, and then every now and then we'll have strategic turns, which are the lettered turns. So the optional rule says there'll be no replacements on strategic turn A. And that mainly is big for the white player because the reds get a significantly higher proportion of replacements every turn, depending on how many resource hexes they hold in key cities, I believe. I think they have to hold Tula, Moscow, and Petrograd. And then for every three resource cities above that, or three they hold, they get another. So they're looking at least like three replacements every turn. A replacement is a unit that you put back on the board in a disrupted form. So it's not like they come back fresh and ready to go, but it can be really disheartening as the white player to work so hard to knock out three armies or four armies only to see three or four reappear at the next strategic turn. So this optional rule gives the whites a little bit more breathing room and ability to make the reds sort of sweat it out a little more and really focus on you know, making sound strategic plans on how they want to deal with the white problems. Or the problem the whites present, not just white problems, I suppose. So let's take a look at chits. Basically, what we have to decide is what chits we're going to use. The white player starts off with these four, AFSR, North Islamic, the Siberian, the Allied Front, and logistics always gets thrown in. The red player always gets a field staff. That's sort of an activate any front. But fronts cannot be activated twice. So if you use this to activate a front, let's say I had the field staff chit and the north chit in the cup, and I draw the field staff chit first, and I'm like, oh, I'm going to activate the north front. Well, I don't get to just draw the north and then activate it again. This actually gets removed or disregarded if I've already activated that front. So the field staff chit's really for activating fronts you don't have chits for, or in emergencies having to respond to something if you can't get to it fast enough by drawing the actual chit. So field staff goes in, and then you get to pick two additional chits that you don't have leaders for. So we have no leaders out. So I need to pick two fronts. The biggest fronts to really worry about here are the, let's pan over here. So the southern front here, which you can kind of see is outlined sort of by those red dots right there. It's much easier in person on camera. Maybe it looks a little busy or confusing. And as you can see, it deals with mainly the AFSR forces, which are down here. So we're definitely going to want to get the southern front into the game. And the other one we're going to want to go for is the eastern front. And the eastern front is up there. And it is a much more broad-based front. It kind of is huge. But as you can see, it's also where the main Siberian forces are. So we have our red train there, of course, and some armies. So the east front is going to be our second choice of chit we're going to have. And what we'll use the field staff chit for is we'll just sort of use it to bring in reinforcements from other fronts. So we have here sort of, this is the west front over here, north front is up here, and what front is, oh, the southwest front. But the southwest front doesn't open up till after strategic turn B. So that's what we'll use the field staff chit for, is sort of move our guys around to whatever front we feel or deem requires the most attention. So now we look at sort of our chits we have for the white player, and we sort of are going to make a decision, well, we don't have to actually make decisions, but for this first turn, because we're using optional rules, we need to pick which fronts we want to activate first. And honestly, the only ones that have any substantial forces is going to be AFSR and the Siberian fronts. Okay, so what we're going to do, let's look at the expanded sequence of play. And First off, we would determine who has initiative, and you just roll a die and use the results. If the red player has a leader in the field staff box, then they get to add plus one to their rolls. You can choose to put a leader in there, but then that doesn't give you any of the leader bonuses in terms of overstacking and a hex, which the leaders do confer on their various fronts. And you don't get that chit for free, right? Because the field staff chit you always get. So the only real bonus is to get plus one on the initiative. But this is a D6 roll, so plus one is pretty hefty advantage. So normally you would roll to see who gets the initiative, but the whites are going to have the initiative this turn. So next we're going to roll for random events. Now this is what makes Reds really more of an interesting game. It gives it a lot of replayability beyond the fact that it's a chip pool game and you're going to get random turn activations. The events chart is really fun. You can get some really interesting and wacky results. You can also get some, well, not wacky, I should say, but some interesting results. You can get some things that can really put the white player in a bind real quickly, or you can get things that don't help you at all. So we'll take a look here. We start with the non-initiative player. That's going to be the red player. So we're going to roll two dice. We're going to sum it. We're going to see what we get. Ooh, 11. Nice. Okay, so if you look here, 11 says red leader. So if we look there, it says randomly select a leader not yet in play, if any, and either place him on the field staff command box or roll a die and assign him to the indicated front command. So I guess you don't get to choose it. I forgot. You have to roll to see what front they'd come on. So it's sort of random there. If there's already a leader in that box, that leader's removed and may re-enter play through a subsequent red leader random event. So the red's getting off to a hot start here, able to pull a leader out. So what we do is we have all these different leader tokens. Going to use our chit cup here and do those out. And we're going to draw. Right, so what do we have here? That is. Can I get you to focus on that? Good. Yeah, Igorov. All right, so Igorov is a one value leader, which is pretty good because most of their see we got a one, we have a zero, there's a two, and a two. So actually, he's not one of the best leaders, but he's better than the zero guy. And the question is, what should we do? Should we take a chance and roll and see if we get one of these fronts activated, or should we just start putting our advantage in the field staff chit? Ooh, and this is the one though, so this would help us with overstacking, and that could be immediately helpful if I managed to roll either the south or the east, even though that would be sort of a waste. Well, it's never really a waste. You do get to have two chits of your own choice, but but there's a chance it could be one of these fronts I won't use, like Central Asia that much, or Southwest, or the field staff is the immediate bonus. I think what we're going to do is we're going to put in the field staff because in other games, I haven't done that, but then honestly, winning initiative is very big for the red player because it lets you, I believe it lets you select the very first chit. You get to decide what you want to start off with, and I believe that's the main benefit of going first. Benefits of initiative. The order in which the players conduct the random events phase and strategic movement phase depends on who has initiative. In addition, the player with initiative will also get to select one of his activation chits to be played. Yeah. So essentially, you get to respond because the non-initiative player always goes first in terms of random events and strategic movement. And then you also get to select your chits. So, it can be very helpful to get those benefits. Okay, so very nice. Got that red leader. Not really what the whites were hoping. They were sort of hoping for either a no event or something that would just be far less helpful. But red leader is a pretty good one. So now we'll roll for the white event. They roll a four. Ooh, tanks. Oh, that does not help us at all. Let's see if I can get this on here. Yeah, if it's after turn B and before major allied withdrawal, place a white tank unit if available with any supplied non-rating AIF, AFSR, Northwest, or Polish, blah, blah, blah. Well, it's not after turn B, and that would actually be awesome, but we don't get the tanks. So that's not so great for the whites there. But, the random events are not always going to be helpful. Sometimes they are. It would have been nice to have maybe gotten an airplane. Could we have gotten a plane? Yeah, we could have gotten a plane, or we could have gotten a flotilla or an armored train, things that actually would have been helpful, but that's okay. We'll take this. So one thing I probably should have done in the beginning, because when we start a new game, you have to see whether or not the Tsar is able to be rescued or miraculously escapes or dies. So we're going to roll a die. If we roll a one, he lives. If we roll anything else, he dies. And of course, that hops out of my little rolly thing. Oh, he dies. All right. R.I.P. So that was a. Find this die. There we go. Okay. If the Tsar lives, it makes it easier to rally units. I think you get a free rally and you get a plus one modifier to your rally attempts. So it's actually really nice to get that. But again, a one in six chance not always happens. I had one game where it did happen and it really does help. It can really give you a snowball effect in the beginning too if you use the optional rules. So you remember one of those optional rules was that three units start off in full strength rather than disrupted. And it's those three here. It's Kornilov, oh God, Drozdovsky. Is that how I'm saying that? Let me see if I got that right. Drozdovsky and Markov. So they're going to be sitting here, and they start off rallied. And that's a big advantage for these guys, because if you look at their reverse, I mean, if you remember how combat works, it really is about the number of units you bring, but it's also the modifiers your units create. And these guys, if they start off disrupted, not only are they not replaceable because they have the dots, and if they die, they're out. But they have negative modifiers, ugh, especially defensive and even offensive, no good. Keep these guys rallied though, and it's a whole different story. Suddenly we have positive modifiers, especially on the attack. This makes the stack much more lethal. So that's one of the optional advantages there, right? That's one of the big reasons helps give the whites more longevity, especially in the southern front, because you don't have a lot to work with. You have two Cossacks here. And they're good, but they can only work within 8 hexes of their Krug. Right now, that's pretty good, but when this front opens up, it's going to be less effective, and they tend to get chewed up pretty fast. The Kuban Cossacks start off disrupted, and you have the Terek Cossacks over there, but they are surrounded by some armies. So the key thing to remember here, so I guess what we're doing is we selected AFSR and Siberian. So those will be the two we choose. The logistics, North and Islamic and Allied, go into the cup. All right, so we look at the sequence of play, and we're going to skip strategic movement on turn one. Next turn, we'll actually be able to do it. It's not too hard, it's fairly easy, but we're going to skip it now. So we do the action phase. This is actually where we would have determined the chits that are available. And so I sort of jumped ahead on the gun there, but it's okay. It's the first turn. We'll get that right the next time. And then we just do initiative activation set segment. The chick. And that's basically where we pull chits, and this is where we start moving things around. So, if you have initiative, this is the one where you get to choose the one you're going to have. And we're going to choose the AFSR first, because it's their interesting situation here, and I got the camera here, and we can go back to Siberia. They have their own interesting things we need to do first, but we'll stick with the AFSR and start moving around. Okay, so movement in this game is easy. You can see most guys have like three, some have four. Movement rates are 1 hex for almost anything except for mountains. So mountain hex is 2. Swamp and forest hexes are also 2. And you don't really see them up here, but in the north we'll see more forest hexes. And but rail lines don't confer any special movement ability. And everything else is just mainly 1. You cannot cross a lake hex side. And you can only cross the Volga, I believe, on rail hexes. I don't know if you can cross the Volga just by being next to it. Let's see. It has double stars. So a unit must stop unless it began its movement on a Volga hex and is moving along it or leaves across a railroad hex side. Yeah, so I'm thinking you have to cross at a railroad hex side to get across the Volga. Because it's just such a large river, so this makes this Saratov makes that important. And if you even touch it, you have to stop unless you start there, and then you can move up along it or cross in a railroad hex. So the Volga is kind of an interesting little feature here. You have to remember that rule. I might have to actually look up the Volga rules, but we'll get there when we talk about the north because it's going to be more important when we do the Siberian turn. Okay, so we've drawn the AFSR. Let's get down to it and see what we can do here. So the big thing we notice right away is that Tsaritsyn is going to be very difficult to take. It would be nice. It is sort of a open spot. It's a rail line, has nice good movement on both sides. It's a defensive spot because of the Volga. And if you remember, you have to have a unit on a hex side with the Volga. Maybe you can't just cross it. Can you actually just cross the border? Should probably stop and do this off camera, but it's so annoying to put these videos together later that it's just easier just to sort of ramble through and see if I can find what I need. I'm not seeing it right away here. Movement, combat, rail, river, rail. We know about strategic movement. That's fine. Anyway, I'm going to take a break probably later and look that up, but we'll figure that out. It's not going to be that important right now. But so you can see there's already some beduff, or a great topic or a great city to grab. It is not even a red city, but it does have the red Verdun marker, which means if you don't attack, or if you attack with anything or any stack and it doesn't have tanks, they can ignore all retreat results here, which makes it much more difficult to take. That's why those tanks would have been great if we could have had them, because you can just sort of steam right up there and go get them. Instead, what we need to think about, though, is these two units down here. And the reason I point that out is because the logistics chit has not been drawn yet, and these units currently are out of supply, governing by the supply rules. They are cut off from using the rail lines, they don't have a river, and they're more than one hex away from a line of supply. That's good for us. If we can weaken them and disrupt them, then when the logistics chit comes up, they'll be eliminated, because any unit that's out of supply, it loses a step, essentially. It becomes disrupted or is removed. Now, of course, these armies are never really truly removed. They just kind of go into the soon-to-be-resurrected pile. But because the special rules say there are no replacements, if we can knock these two armies out, then that's going to pay off dividends down the line. Because we'll get, let's see, 1, 2, 3, 4 actual turns before they'll actually be able to replace anything we move up, remove off the board. So let's start thinking. What would be a good attack? We need to really take on this guy. And if you remember, zones of control are sticky, and you have to leave it and then move around. You can't just move from zone of control to zone of control. Some units can. They're very rare. When they come up, we'll deal with them. And we have to remember our stacking limit is 6, right? So we have 1, 2, we only have 3 units here. I have 2 here with the Kuban Cossacks, and I have some Cossacks up here. But I need to kind of consider the fact that the Reds might start to bring forces down and want to take this city, especially because it is their home Krug. And it also just gives a nice little jumping off point to harass other units there. I could think about sending these guys up here to attack. This would be kind of a risky attack, but one that could very easily pay off. If I do manage to take this out, it's unlikely they'll bring any unit from Tsaritsyn down to take this, because that would be leaving this completely open, and they don't have that many units in the front. As we can, if we look up here, we can see, I mean, there's a couple of things, but you also see the Siberians are very close up here, and the Reds are going to have to really think about. This is a much more potent force in the beginning, but this is, you know, nothing to be trifled with either. What to do? Should I move the Cossacks over here? Could I even do that? Let's make sure I can even do that. It would cost me 1, 2 movement. Yeah, I could do that. And attack them, and that would be, what would they have? They have +2, +4 modifier. That could be really good. And it would be a 1-to-1 attack. He's not on a city, so it would be an even attack. I mean, we would have to get a really, really good result to not take a disruption, because it's pretty much how the CRT is here. It's disruption heavy. But that would be, that's such a good gamble. We might have to do that. Normally, you're not supposed to be too gambly with the whites, because it can really bite you in the butt. And I could bring these guys over here to help with this attack. That's the other thing I could do, right? So I think what we'll do is we'll move these guys here. We'll bring up the Kubans, and they're going to go 1. Oh, actually, he won't be able to. Oh, he's got 4 movement. Good. 1, 2, 3. So now we have 5. So they can't have any more units stacked with them. But I could bring the Cossacks and go 1, 2, 3 and attack there. Or they can go, was it 1, 2, 3, 4? No, that wouldn't work. Or we can send them up there. This is a pretty much good attack. If it's got 4 units against 1, even though he's got good modifiers, he is in a city. If I bring these guys down, though, we can get 2-to-1 odds. And that's actually very good, because he's in a city, so he's going to get the shift over anyway. Tough decisions. And I have this guy, but he can't really do anything. He can't go through the desert, and he can't get around that unit, so he's sort of stuck hanging out there.
Let me take a break. I'll come right back. I'm gonna ponder this for a second. So I think we're gonna get risky and we're gonna go take these guys up here. And they're gonna attack. The reason is because I was thinking about the battle calculations here, and here's what I determined. If we attack this guy, we're gonna have four units attacking, which is good for our modifiers if we roll high. But we have to look at sort of our, you know, modifiers in terms of attack and defense. Now he has a plus two defense here, and I have 2, 4, 6 minus one, because that guy brings a negative modifier. That's plus five, and then we also have to remember that he's gonna get a modifier in his favor, right? So automatically, before we roll a die, we know we're gonna have a plus three modifier. And hopefully we'll be able to get more than that, because he'll roll either, he won't be able to get a high multiplier because he only has one unit in the battle. We will have four. Hopefully we beat them fairly well in the roll. And if we do that, we don't have to do much better to reduce him and achieve our results we want to get. We'll probably take a step loss. There's probably no way to avoid that, because we will be attacking at 1 to 2 odds. Up here, it's an even better situation, though. This guy does not have a shift because he's not on city, and we are attacking him from the river that he's on. And he has a negative modifier, and we have plus modifiers here. So it's a 1-to-1 combat here, but we're just going to have overwhelming odds in terms of hopefully being able to get a better roll than he will. Things could be a lot more dicey up here because he only has one unit, we have two. That's not a huge modifier, but we'll figure it out, right? So let's do it. Let's see what's going to happen. Normally when you declare combat, you declare who's attacking, and then both sides can decide if they want to use their armored train assets or naval assets or air assets or, you know, the various little things they can declare to have in the battle or not. None of those are in play now, so we don't have to worry about that. Instead, we'll just say we're attacking here. So we determine the odds. So this is what we have. 3, 4, 5 to 4. This is a 1-to-1 odds, but because this guy's in a town, he gets a shift in his favor, so it becomes 1 to 2, yeah, 1 to 2 attacking odds. Now we roll a die. Okay, so we got 5 and a 3. So what does that mean? Well, that's good for the whites. 5 times 4 is 20, so we have 20 points automatically, and we know we're also going to get 5 more because of the modifiers there, so we have 25. The red unit gets 3, so 3 times 1 is 3. We add in his there, and he gets plus 2 for defending, and he gets a 5. And we get the difference. The difference is 20. If we look at 1 to 2 combat odds with a plus 20 differential, that's an ADR, attacker and defender retreat. All defenders would suffer a result. The attacker would suffer just one. It's a little a, not a big A. Here, I'll show you, actually. It's just... So we did 1 to 2 combat odds, and you can see here we had plus 20, so it was little ADR. So he has to retreat, he takes a disruption result, so do we. And I think what we'll do is we'll just have... I could get rid of the Cossacks and just sort of sacrifice them, because these guys are just irreplaceable, and honestly their stats get a lot worse when they start taking hits, especially on the defense, as you remember. I think that's what we'll do. We'll sort of just kill off the Cossacks. They will come back. Sorry, Cossacks. You guys were super fun, but you're out. So I'll put you down here. They can come back. Actually, they won't come back, so there's no replacements, but they'll come back later in the game. So that may be kind of risky or sad to lose those guys. It's sometimes you're like, well, now I the other thing, though, is I could keep him. Could keep him and have one of these guys take a loss and just maintain the, like, superiority in my stack, which I think we'll just do that. Now that I think twice about it, this sucks having more negative modifiers, especially if we get attacked, but we're not likely to be attacked anytime really soon. And this is gonna let me still keep my like 4 stack ability and not lose manpower points and things like that. So those are the kind of things to consider. This guy, meanwhile, he takes his disruption loss and now he has to retreat 2 hexes. He'll go there. Now let's go to this combat in the north. So here we got a 1-to-1 attack straight up. Oh, let me get a little closer. There we go, sorry about that. So here we have a straight up 1-to-1 attack because it's 4 units against 4. We're attacking on the river, so he doesn't get his defensive shift. And we're going to roll 2 die. Okay, so here's interesting results. This is where we can start seeing some of the things. Red rolled a 5, white rolls a 3. So 3 times 2 is 6. And we know they get plus 4, so that equals a 10. 5 times 1 is 5, minus 1 is 4. So the differential here is 6. And plus 6 on a 1-to-1 attack. If we could have gotten one more, we wouldn't have suffered an attacker result, but that's okay. It's a little a, little d, r, which means we take a loss. He takes a loss and would retreat, but he's out. So this unit is toast. We'll put him down. Where did I put that white unit? No, I didn't. The white unit didn't die. Okay, so we're going to put that army down here. The Ninth Army bites it. Okay, so I forget. Can we advance after combat? Is there such a thing? Yes, attacking units may advance into the defending hex if the combat eliminates or retreats all defenders. Armor trains can advance only along rail lines, river flotillas advance only along rivers, and enemy zone of control has no effect on advance after combat. Units that are in supply may not advance after combat into a hex which is out of supply. Okay, so he couldn't actually go. Well, he could go here. No, he couldn't because he'd be out of supply because this unit's zone of control negates that. He can go here because that's there. So we'll just keep him here. Actually, would he have been able to move there? Hold on 1 second. Let me double check something real quick. Well, I've already made the first major mistake. I forgot. This rule is kind of one of these little cruddy little rules that you forget about and then you're like, ah. Oh. You cannot move out of supply. You cannot move a unit out of supply. It just can't ever be done. What that means essentially is I couldn't come up here to attack this unit because this guy negates the river hex there. Now, if I left a unit here, then I could have come up and attacked him. But that would have not been an optimal attack. And honestly, I couldn't have done that because you have to stop movement in a zone of control. I guess I could have sent him up there and then gone 1-2 and that would have worked. But having both units here, because he negates the supply there, and the supply hex is not right here. The other thing, though, is this rail line doesn't count either because it goes up here for the river, and this is also negated hex. This is not open, because if we could have had this line open here, then I could have traced it back there. That won't work either. So we've already goofed up pretty badly, actually, because now I don't know. I should have made this attack down here a little better. That's where he goes, right? I was wondering why that was a little too easy to begin with. Okay, so that was a mistake, a big mistake, because it's sort of annoying because it doesn't help us at all right here. I should have had more units attacking that guy. So I guess what we'll do is we'll just reset, because that's so early on. That's so much wasted video. I'm really sorry, that's so much wasted time. That's really annoying. Okay, well, I'm kind of annoyed at myself because that's a lot of wasted time, but that's okay. Okay. So now we have to think about what we're going to do here. Because I would have brought these guys over, obviously. I would not try to risk any losses this early. I don't really want to leave this open, though. He could bring 2 armies down to attack it. But this would give me the 2-to-1 odds if I can get even one more unit down there. So that's what we're going to do. I'm just going to go 1, 2, 3. He's going to come down here. So that's going to make this weaker. It's going to leave it open to attack from here. But again, like I said, they can't get too aggressive. So we're going to have to do that just so we can also keep them from like zooming down here and blocking off our supply. So we'll keep him here to sort of stop any movement that way. I could almost even just like move him up there, but it's easy. You should stay on the city because it gives you a better defensive bonus. Okay, so here we go. We're going to attack here. We have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 units against that 1 red, so we roll die. All right, so we got a 4 and a 3 result, so we know we have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, so we have 20 there. We have 2, 4, 6, 8, because that's now the plus 2 there. Minus 1 is 7, so we have a total of 27. He rolled a 3. 3 times 1 is 3. Minus 1 is 2. So we have clearly a huge differential here. This was a 2-1 attack, because there are 8 points here, but he's in a city. So that became a 1-1 attack. So a 1-1 attack with a huge differential is a DR. That's right. So don't even... That's what we would have done. So... Oh, he was full strength, I forgot. Oh, shit. He was full strength, so hold on. 3 plus 2 is 5. Oh, we're still huge. We're still good. The differential is huge. So we get a DR result. He's going to have to get reduced, and he has to retreat, and he has to go at least 2 hexes away from the attacker and not go through zones of control, or he loses more, right? So he's going to have to go 1, 2, because, of course, he can't retreat and be out of supply either, even though it technically is. I guess when you're out of supply already, you can do whatever you want. You can't just move into it. If something happens and you become out of supply, then you can move and do whatever you want, which is a strange rule, but you cannot willingly move into an out-of-supply position. Anyway, that was a goof there. Oops. So we got that attack. He's put over there. The Terek Cossacks aren't going to do anything because they're not really that strong. We'll see if these units try to gang up and maybe take it out. We'll see what happens there if they manage to get drawn before we can do anything else. So yeah, they moved. They did that. That's pretty good. And I think we're done with the AFSR. That is their move. Okay, so that shit's done. It's out here. Now we know next we're going to have up is the Siberians. So let's go take a look at what's happening with our friends in the north. All right. So the big thing about the north is they have to get over here and take the people's gold. Let's see if I can get a better camera angle. Not perfect, but it works. So the big thing here is that the whites have a lot of interesting positions we need to think about. We're going to worry about this guy up here in a second. But the big thing is getting the people's gold, because that's worth one resource for us, and that's what we use to stave off Alec withdrawal. So having that counts as ownership of a resource city, which you can see we're sitting in right now also in Simbirsk. We've got some stiff competition around us, and the thing is, the gold is held by a garrison unit. It's not a big deal, but it is a red city. It does have 2 rivers into it, so we need to find a way to attack it on both rivers and seize what is rightfully ours. So I think what we're going to do is we're going to take these units here. We have the people's unit, we have the Capel unit, we have the second check, and we're going to try to bring all the pain. All the pain. What can we do here? Can't move this Czech unit in support. These Cossack units can't make it over. Yeah, because it just wouldn't be enough. But what they can do is sort of help reinforce other cities. So you kind of see those Cossack units there, right? So I think what we're going to do is we'll move these guys just one up here because they have to stay on the Volga. If they left it, that'd be not a good move for them. We'll bring this Czech unit over. He will come and go 1, 2, right? So now he's on that river, so we can also negate the defensive bonuses of the rivers because now we're on both. We'll still get the city bonus. There's not much we can do about that. He has a garrison unit, though, so he's just a 1 strength unit. That's helpful. And then we'll also bring up some of these Cossacks to help guard up in Simbirsk. So what do we got? 1. Oh, shit. He can't make it over there. What am I going to do here? All right, hold on, let me take a break. I want to see if I can put a garrison unit in Simbirsk. Hold on. All right, so when you leave a city, you can place a garrison if you have one available. I do, so we'll put one there. It's not a very good garrison. Garrison units are not great, but they do take up space. And we'll go ahead and move these Cossacks closer to get them into the battle quicker. So let's see, what would be the best place to do that? 1, 2, probably 3, 4, yeah. 1, 2, 3, 4. And then the Orenburg Cossacks, we will bring them over as well. I'm going to do 1, 2, 3, 4. We'll just bring one to Smyrna. Okay. Bring those check units there. If we look over here before we do our attacks, let's figure out what we want to do with our Siberian friends up here. They're sort of way up there. This is where we're going to hide the gold when we get it. But they have to move down. So let's get him down here. So he's going to go 1, 2, 3. Or he could just hang out there and do operational movement next turn, which would kind of be big. And he won't be able to get there anyway in a couple turns. So actually, we'll just keep him there. The first check. This unit is going to probably have to hold there because it's going to keep... these armies from getting out of that army and that garrison from really bringing it. Although I really don't want them to come down here. So what I think we'll do is we'll move the Czech unit. If I could put him on the river, it's better defensive territory. But the moment I enter, leave this hex open, he can zoom up to a Katrinburg. I don't think he would really do that. But if he gets into mountains do do give you a shift in your own favor for defense. Yeesh. So indecisive. Am I in a mountain now? I am not in a mountain now, so it will not necessarily matter. I could just go, if I go down here, then he can't do anything. So yeah, we'll just go down here and we'll see if he brings it. We'll see if he wants to attack. I doubt he will. That will keep him from moving, because the zone of controls will keep him from really doing anything crazy. Okay. Let's get our people's gold battle on. Okay, so what do we have here? I couldn't bring anybody else that close, so we've got this attack going on here. I wonder if I should have put a unit here as well, but I don't really want to expose them too much, and there are many red armies waiting to come in and pounce. Yeah, okay. So we'll attack here. So we're on both rivers. Go ahead and remove this gold so we can just tell it's just a crummy old garrison unit. And we're attacking with, let's see, 1, 2, I believe it's 4. Yeah, 3, 4 manpower units to 1. So this is a 4-to-1 attack. We have 3 units, he has 1. Let's roll a die. Oh man, so this is a good example of how these can go south pretty fast. This is actually the worst roll we could have gotten. This is actually really bad for us. Man, not so good for the whites. Okay, so we have 3 units attacking times 1 is 3. Luckily we get some nice bonuses here on the attack because they are fairly good units. 3, 4, 5, 6. 6 equals 9. This is not good. 6 to 1 minus 2, so he gets 4. So 9 minus 4 is only a 5 plus 5 differential on a 4 to 1. Just enough, though. Just enough. That is a big D retreat. So anytime these guys get a retreat result, they are vaporized. They're done. I believe they can. You know, I say that again, and I feel like there's another one of these little rules. You maybe have to actually do a hit on it. I gotta tell you, one thing I do not like about the rulebook is it does not have an index. It has no index, and so it's incredibly difficult to find things when you can't remember exactly where it's at. An index would have solved all that. But like, you know, I'm looking for garrisons, and it's just, okay, here we go. Disordered and order of supplies. Let's see. Doesn't say here, and I feel like there's a special rule about this. So now we're going to go to combat, and see, this is taking too long. This is already taking too long, so they really need to, okay, here's, see, here it is, a special little note under combat results.
Garrison units alone in a hex may only be eliminated by an R result. You have to get an R result. You cannot get a D result. It will not kill them. See, this is something that's not written in the section of the rules that deals with garrison units. This is literally under the combat results section, and it's a special note under retreat. So this is one of those rules that if you did not see it, you'd be playing the game wrong. So I knew there was some special garrison rule. So luckily we got it right, because you have to get a retreat when it's a lone unit in the hex. So he's gone. He gets vaporized. He can come back later, though. That's big for us. We're going to advance after combat. We come in there, and we're going to take possession of the gold. Now, Kazan would normally be a great place to hang out and hold out, but it's a red city, which means we don't get any defensive bonuses for being in it as a white player. But we do get the defensive bonuses for being on the river. They probably can't be on the Kama River, but they can get on the Volga. Regardless, we got the gold, so we are going to move our resources up one, and the reds go down one. So the reds now have four. We have three. I think I moved everybody else I want to move. Yeah, so that's the Siberian one. So now we go to the... Oh, logistics. Alright, so when we do a logistics phase... Dun, 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 dun. Let's look that up. Okay, let's see. If logistics, okay, we do a white supply step. We check supply for all friendly units, and of course we... let's double check that. Alright, so this is where we look at the board and we see if anybody is out of supply. So these guys are not out of supply because they have rail lines that trace all the way back to their supply point, which is over there in Omsk, and nothing is cut off because we moved that guy down there. It actually was a key cutoff here next to Perm because it negates that zone of control. Although we would have had rivers and rail lines, because remember you can use a combination of river and rail to get supply. So all these guys are in supply. There are no red units out of supply in this front. They're actually pretty good. That is not necessarily the case down here in the south. Okay, both these units are out of supply. He takes a disruption. He's eliminated. Okay, that's good luck for us. That actually was a nice little turn of good luck, because if they had actually gotten their activation first, they might have been able to attack the Terek Cossacks and weaken them. It would have been a suicide attack, or they could have come over here and tried to get the Don or something else. It wouldn't have been a great move, but they could have tried something, and now they absolutely don't have any options, so that's really good for us. It'll make mopping up the 12th Army easy, and then we can start begin focusing on moving up here to Tsaritsyn. And let's see, so are there any white units out of supply? The Terek Cossacks are not out of supply because they're on their home Krug Hex, and they're always in supply when they're on their Hex. And so yeah, it's pretty early in the game, not a lot of things have been cut off from supply, so that's pretty good. Okay, next. The red rally step. We check supply. Wait, I didn't do that. Oh, we do the white rally, sorry. Attempt to rally disordered units, and we may remove garrisons at this time. So this is the time you can pick up garrison units that you've put in cities and put them back into your holding pile. It's really key to know when to move your garrisons, because you only get so many of them, and they really do hold your lines of supply and act as little buffer units. So this is when you could remove them if you want. As a white player, I'm not going to remove any of my garrisons. I'm pretty happy where they're at right now. So let's attempt to rally disordered units. Let's see, I want to make sure I get this right. Okay. We get to roll a die for each of our supplied disordered units on the map and check the result against the type of unit on the rally table to see if it rallies. So where is the rally table? I forget. I know we... Where's the rally table? Oh, it's on my... my player aid sheet. Okay, so let's take a look at the rally table. So that's what you have to roll. Pretty low numbers, unless you're the AIF, which they'll probably be able to get their stuff. And then Poland won't matter, and we don't have Wrangle with the AFSR. Red with the red train get auto. But we're going to do with white units, and then we'll do red units here. So the main thing we got to worry about is white, non-AIF, Pole. It is 1-2, and after major withdrawal, you see it's 1. It's much more difficult. So let's take a look at our disrupted units that we have. We got a couple, right? We got those Kubans there, and we have, that's it, right? So we're going to roll a die to see if the coupon comes back. Where did my dice go? Oh, they're up here. Nope.
Is there anybody else in the whites? Nope, that is the only not disrupted unit. Okay, so they're good to go. Now we do the same thing for reds. This guy cannot flip over because he's out of supply, so he doesn't get to attempt to. But we can see up here that the Ninth Army can, because he is in supply. So we're going to roll, and he needs, I believe, a 1 or a 2 as well. He does not. We look around at other ones. Okay, we can go to the north here. So we can see here that the Fifth Army could be rallied. It's not. And then there's also this army up here. It's in supply. It does not. There is an army over here that is in supply. Damn it. It does not. And then there's also an army in Petrograd you cannot see off camera. I'm going to roll for it. And it actually rallies. Okay. Okay, so that's the rally step. The red player could remove garrisons if it wanted to, but it won't. And that is the logistics chit. All right. All right, so let's see what else we got. Let's see what the next chit is. The east. So this is a red chit. We're going to activate the east front. And that is going to be the one dealing with the whites up here. So they're in Kazan. And we also have this unit up here. So I'm going to take a break, and when I come back, we'll discuss what's going to be done for the east front. So I started looking at the board again. It's been a little bit since I did the last video, and I was thinking of what I wanted to do with the east front activation. And because I'm just a little rusty, I moved this check unit up because I wanted to preserve what I thought would be the line of supply for logistics, but of course I've forgotten that I could just use the Kama River and come over here and take the rail all the way back to Omsk, which is off camera, so that this rail junction really isn't as important as I initially believed it to be. And I've also opened myself up here to a 4-1 attack, albeit by a reduced army, but there is a 1/3 chance that that army wouldn't be eliminated and that the Czech unit would take a step loss and have to retreat. So I'm just going to take this back, take backsies, and mainly because I'm just, that was silly. Like, I wouldn't have made that move otherwise. I've just kind of forgotten about how supply works, and the fact that you can use the river-rail combination, and I do have access to the rivers back here without being cut off by any red units yet. So instead of hanging out, he started off here. So instead of going there, we're going to just have him. So the question is, I could move him back to Ekaterinburg. And in doing so, that would make him eligible for strategic movement later, because you have to start in a city and end up in a city using strategic movement. The white player can move 2 manpower points of Siberian and armed forces of South Russia plus the gold on strategic movement. And the red player gets up to 9 manpower points, and he can also move the gold, or she can move the gold if they possess it. So I could move him back here, but then the truth is I have this other unit in Omsk that I'm going to use for strategic movement, the, what was that, the 1st Siberian. So I think what we're going to do instead is we're going to take this Czech unit, and he's just going to hang out in the mountains. Mountains provide a defensive shift to the left, so even if this unit decided to get adventurous on its turn and come out and attack the Czechs, and now I think that would, it would eliminate any chance it would have of not being eliminated itself in an attack. It could try to come down here and put pressure. That's fine. We can move the Czech later and come down and hopefully rejoin his comrades and hopefully become more a unified force. Because right now the Siberian whites are a little scattered. And there's not a huge amount of threats, but you know, that still is a fairly sizable army. I mean, we only have 1 manpower point. There's 4 there. The 1st Siberian is 2 manpower points. But really what we got to think about here is going down here in Kazan. This is where the main action's happening, right? So we seize the gold here in Kazan, but Kazan is a red city, and that means it's going to be difficult to hold under sustained attack because we don't get the defensive bonus for being in a red city, seen as we're white units. We do have one advantage coming our way, and that's the fact that we have two rivers. One will be negated, obviously, because the reds can just sort of cruise up it. That's the Volga right there. But we also have the Kama River here, and so if they can't get a unit on here, then we get a defensive shift for them not having a unit attacking from the Kama River. So at least that's one shift we can get. It's not amazing, because as you can see, during East Activation, we can, as the red player, present up to 12 manpower points in an attack on Kazan, which I think we're going to do. Garrisons do not project a zone of control. I could try to come over here and attack Simbirsk and take that city, because it is a resource city, and that does hurt the whites, because they have to have resource cities or resources to keep the allies interested in the war in general. Seizing the gold does give them 1 point, but if I take Simbirsk, then I could, you know, make that a null effort, essentially. But I think the smarter move is actually to just put more pressure on the stacks of whites here, because their total manpower points is 2, 3, 4. So it has 4. But these are all non-replaceable units, as indicated by the dots there, right? So if I can even inflict 1 step loss on them, it could put them in a bind, considering that we've already had the logistics phase, so they won't get to rally until next turn when the logistics chit is pulled again. I would like to have been able to get the red train next to this army to give it an auto rally. I don't think we're going to be able to do that, because the red train can only move during strategic movement. After everybody's strategically moved, the red train can move. So what we're going to do is we're going to think here. What's the best way? We could probably... Yes, I think that's... Although that would put him out of supply. I could move this army and go 4 counts as 2, so I could go 1, 2, 3, and that potentially would cut off some of the retreat results if they did get a retreat result. But by putting him here, that would also put him out of supply. And as we know, we cannot move anywhere where we put ourselves out of supply. Although I guess I could put this guy here. If he was here, then that still is out of supply. Yeah. If we had Izhvesk, Izhvesk. If we had taken that, then I could maybe potentially have been here, because the rail could have been traced back through Perm. But because of that, we're just going to have to go here. So we'll attack there. He comes up here on the river, because he started on the river, so he can move up the Volga. And then this unit will go 1, 2 as well. All right. Is there anybody else in the east I want to move? I can't move the train unit. I do have this army up in Perm, but I think it's just going to hang out in Perm, because it really serves no advantage to try to come down here and cut it off. Not really. Maybe. I don't know. Honestly, though, with 3 movement points, they could still come down here and attack Izhvesk. It wouldn't be, like, that hard to do. So we'll just keep them there for the defensive bonus. We'll be a little more conservative with the reds here. You do have to be kind of aggressive, because if you want to try to go for the full game and capture every city, you don't really have a lot of time to, like, dally about and not be pressing forward. But he's weakened, and until we can sort of clean up this area here and move up, let's just keep him in the city and hanging out, because if he gets extended and eliminated, then we've exposed this entire northern rail route, and that can be a real quick way to threaten Moscow, which does not have a ton of protection right now. Okay, so we got our attack here. What do we have? 12 manpower. So we got, I guess I'll do it over here. I'm left-handed, so that's always fun. We got 12 to 4. So that's a 3-to-1 attack. He's not attacking on that one river, right? So it becomes a 2-to-1 attack. We'll go ahead and add up the modifiers now, even though you do that later, but we'll just go ahead and do it now. So as you can see, armies that are not, or armies that are organized for the reds have quite potent modifiers here. So it's plus 6 total. That one has a 0, so we have plus 6. The defenders have 1, so those units, not so great there. So we have a total differential of plus 5. So let's roll these die and let's see what kind of multipliers we get. This will be pretty even, right? Because 3 units are attacking 3 units, so we're just going to have to see who wins the ultimate die roll. Ooh, it looks like it might be the whites just edging out the reds with a 3-to-2 result. So 3 times 3 is 9. 3 times 2 is 6. So the difference between those results is 3, right? So we're going to take this down to plus 2. So plus 2 on 2-to-1 attack odds
is attacker, defender, retreat. So little a, little d, r. The defender will have to retreat and take a step loss, but the attackers will have to take a step loss as well.
So I think what we'll do is we'll reduce this army, because this one's a little closer to the units that could potentially be damaging. Tough. Probably what we'll do is take down the Capel unit, even though it gives horrendously bad modifiers when it's reduced. This one also has horrendously bad modifiers. And I think the first check is actually really good, but it's also really good on the offense. So not as bad. We're going to keep the check active, though. I think we'll just reduce Capel. Or Capel. I have a tendency to mispronounce almost everything I encounter. All right, so now they have to retreat as well. And they have to go two hexes. Ooh, the gold does not come with them, I believe. I think the gold has to stay there. All that right. Yeah, correct. Yeah. Let's see if the gold... I don't think the gold gets to move, so this may be kind of a unfortunate result for the whites. It may not retreat. If it's left behind, if units stacked with it, retreat. Well, that is unfortunate for the whites, because that was... it's not a terribly difficult result. They would have had... it would have been difficult. I don't know. They could... they would just rolled one more better, they would have been able to avoid it. But that's sort of the price you pay, I guess, in this game. So they do retreat. They lose the gold. All for naught. It's... you can hold on to it. Most of the time I play this game, they do get to hold on to the gold. And this will make it much tougher for the whites, unfortunately. So they have to retreat two hexes. I think we'll just go ahead and go one... two and stay on the river for defensive bonus purposes, even though they're easily negated. And we can't advance after combat. We will do so. And there we go. Take possession of the gold. Reds go up to five resources. Whites go down to two. Yeah, it's going to be rough. We're going to have to somehow try to seize that again, even though I have a reduced unit. Oh, that's kind of unfortunate. That was some bit of bad luck there, a bit of bad rolls. Would have been nice to have actually beaten them. But then again, this is sort of the way the combat system works. You can see here, I only beat them by one, and I still sort of took my lumps. If I'd rolled a one, he'd roll a six, I would have really taken lumps. So, you know, the combat system is kind of varied. It's interesting. Okay, so that was the East Chit. Let's see who's next. Allied intervention forces. These are pretty easy moves to make, because honestly, it's so difficult to get them into position to do anything, because you have to draw that random event. So the big one here is probably the Trans-Caspian. We'll go ahead and do is move him. One, two, three. You never know. We're just going to start getting him in a position, because maybe he can come up here and attack that lone red position. And it's also a good idea to have a garrison hanging out in Merv if you can, because there are partisan events, and the red player can put a partisan in any city that's not occupied. And he can cut off supply if you have any kind of attack going on up here. Your supply point is right here, or also here. But if you take that, you don't get either. So if you, when you run through that town, it's a good idea to put a garrison unit down. Unfortunately, a white unit will have to do that, but we'll get that moving. So anyway, he moves up. If we come over here, we have the Murmansk and the Archangel and the, was it Onega? Yeah, units. And remember, they can't attack, but they can start beginning to put pressure on different units or moving out and doing whatnot. So I'm not too worried about the garrison unit here, because it can't move or do anything, and it could take those towns. It's not entirely essential, because it's sort of a backwater and has no real implications on zone of control and whatnot, but these points do. So let's go ahead and start moving our Murmansk guy down. He goes one, two, three. So there he is. He's hanging out. We'll bring Onega down and go one, two, three. And Archangel will go one, two, three. All right. So we'll keep them down there. This does mean they could potentially get in an attack on the Fourth Army here if we draw that event. Although with those kind of modifiers, you just, and plus the attack odds, it would be difficult. It would be difficult, but that can happen. Okay.
So that was Allied Forces. And next, I got the South Front. All right, so the South Front, so when last we were at the South Front, the Cossacks, or I should say the Armed Forces of South Russia, with assistance from the Don Cossacks, were able to sort of damage army here, and then logistics came and sort of wiped out that one and reduced this guy. So I think what we're going to do is clean up the 12th Army here, and then we're going to refocus our efforts and start putting the pressure on Tsaritsyn, because even though Siberians have kind of suffered a setback up there, those forces are far away, and if we can put more pressure in the South Front, we're going to have to at least get these armies into at least coming down here and not moving up to attack the Siberians, and that's really what we need to do right now and buy them time. So let's hopefully get some good results down here to negate the somewhat disappointing loss of the gold. Let's go ahead and take another wide-angle view going on. We can come get closer. Alright, so I'm trying to get rid of this guy. I already have this natural unit there. It's kind of the question of, do I want to commit a ton of resources? Because, you know, they only get, like, so many movement points, so it can be difficult to get back into position. Well, I guess that is a city I could strategically move. But remember, you can only move 2 points. So that's one Cossack unit. It could be, you know, one of those and one of those. That's pretty good. But you couldn't move all of them, you know. So I got to think about that. Plus the Dons can only go 8. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Yeah, it's totally fine. The coupons are kind of weak, and we'll just go, we'll just bring it. So he'll go 1, 2, and should be a fairly easy battle. We could even leave this guy behind. I don't even think we need him. Let's see, do we though? 2, 4, 6, yeah, we do, we kind of need. So he's going to go 1, 2, 3. The reason we need him is because we're going to be able to get 2-1 odds, and we need that because he's in a city. So we have 2, 4, 6, 7, 8, 9. That reduces to 2-1, so that becomes a 1-1 attack. Right, so we add up our modifiers here. We got 2, 4, it's a negative, we'll come to you in a second. 2, 4, 6, 8, 10. So we have a 9 modifier. He has a defensive of -1, so that becomes now a +10 modifier. And we roll. So you can pretty much see this guy's gonna die no matter what, right? It's 1-1. The question is just, I don't think it's a question, really. Let's see. Oh, look at that, that fun 4-1. So we have how many units here attacking? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. So we get +6. He gets +4, so that becomes only a +2 modifier. So our total modifier is 10 plus 2. Sorry, all this scribbling probably makes no sense, but it does to me. It's +12 on a 1-1 attack. That just puts us out of range. The light is there. But as you can see, just puts us out of range of not being hurt, right? ADR could have gotten a DR with a +13, but we had +12. Rough. That's what happens when you roll ones and you have a million units attacking. Again, this should have probably been a sure combat, but it wasn't. And that happens. So this guy bites it. And then I get to decide a unit to take a hit. It's going to be the Terek's. They're gonna take that. And we will advance into combat because we can use strategic movement. And that's my dog. Hey, bud. Hey, cut it out. Thanks. Stop. Thank you. All right. Loves to make thumping noises when he scratches. I think if you have dogs, you understand. All right. So 12th Army is out, and we're not going to move that guy because, honestly, he needs to stay there and kind of provide zone of control, and also there's no need to move him out of the city where he gets excellent defensive benefits anyway. All right. We put the pressure on in the south. That was successful. You know, that would have been nice not to have taken a step loss, but it happens. Alright, next. Oh, the field staff chit. Alright, so this lets us activate a front that has not already been activated. So we've done the east and the south. And if we take a look, what else could we bring into? Let's see. The South's already gone. Or no, the South hasn't gone yet, has it? Oh, it did go. Wait, when did I move the South? Oh, goodness me. I'm so... That was really dumb. I just moved the Siberians again. Armed Force South Russia, thinking that was the South, and instead that should have been the Reds. How funny is that? Man, that's some pretty funny mistakes. This is the morning for me. I just had my first cup of coffee, so... Well, that was a fun little diversion, wasn't it? So let's reset. Not too hard to do, right? Where were you guys? You guys were probably back in there. Oh goodness, I don't quite remember, but we'll stay there. I'll look at the video later and fix it. But gosh, how funny is that that I'm just totally spacing on that? Well, that's two diversions now that we've spent some time on, but you know, some of the commentary still remains, right? Okay, so essentially we're not even going to worry about this guy because he has no hope of getting out of the situation. He is out of supply. I guess that does free him from the don't move out of supply rules because he is technically already out of supply. So I guess, although it's a risk, but he's probably going to die anyway. So we'll go 1, 2, 3. And the reason we're going to do that is because if the logistics shit comes up next round before we draw the South Front, yes, that unit will die. If we draw the South Front, though, before the logistics chit and the Armed Force South Russia haven't somehow managed to kill it, which might be kind of difficult considering it's in a totally out-of-supply position, then it can rejoin its comrades up there. Pretty sure that's how that movement... It may not. Let me double-check that rule. A unit may not end its movement in Hex, which would put it out of supply, and then it says go to 12-4, so maybe you can't do that. Seems to... So maybe you just can't do that. I would have thought you could maybe do that. That's one of those confusing parts about that rule. I guess it's out of supply already. Anywhere it moves would put it out of supply. Or I guess it could try to get back into supply. But there's really no way to do that. It could maybe if it could get up here, but this guy projects a zone of control, so he couldn't go through there. You can't go through deserts. Yeah, I guess he's just stuck there. Okay. However, we do have some units up here, actually. Let's bring them over to the elevated position. All right, so the question becomes, what can I do to bring some help into Tsaritsyn? So I have a few armies I can activate. I have this one in Saratov, I have this one just out of Tambov, and I have this ninth army hanging out here. But remember, I can't stack guys because I have a stacking limit of 6. So what I need to do is probably start moving some guys down. Although I hate to just leave Saratov open. So we're probably going to have to keep Saratov, that army, there. He could march over and take the Uralsk Cossacks, Krug. Which would make them out of supply and could put them in a big hole, but then again, I'd be leaving Saratov open, and I don't really want to do that necessarily, because I would put a lot of additional pressure. So he's going to have to hold there. I think what we're just going to have to do is bring these guys down and go 1, 2, 3, and we'll bring this guy and go 1, 2, and he'll have to stop on entering the Volga. Which is okay, because I think then we'll be able to position him down here and do some fun things. So we'll get those guys ready, because that keeps this wounded guy out of the line of fire, and we'll be able to get this guy coming down hopefully soon, and at least hold the line and keep them from taking Tsaritsyn. Because if you remember, I can't go past this barbed wire. It's where the central powers are, so he could come up and swing that way, but we'll maybe try to lock that down by holding this hex or holding this hex. We'll see. Okay, so that was the south. Now we have the field staff chit, field staff, which means we can activate any front that we haven't already activated. Which really is probably going to have to be the west front, because the west front has the Latvian rifles, and they are really good, although I could strategically move them next turn. And everybody here is pretty rallied. There's just not that many armies on the table for me, really. Interesting thought. If I move, where can I move their Latvian rifles? They do kind of need to get into this battle, but he's taken Kazan, so I can strategically move there next turn. So honestly, I don't really need to activate the north front. I mean, I could, but he's just hanging out there, and I think that's a perfectly fine spot to hang out in. I don't need to activate... I guess I could activate the West Front, but that guy needs to stay in Petrograd. So honestly, the Field Sap shit's not going to come in a lot of hand... really in handy right now. Only because I don't have any other armies to bring over to the south. And the Latvian Rifles are already in a city, and I think I'll just use them to strategically move over here to Kazan, or we'll maybe move them down here to the south. I don't know. I'll try to figure out where that's at. But it's just better for them not to move now. They don't really need to. So we'll just kind of keep them there. All right, so Field Staff Chit, not entirely helpful right now. Does become more helpful later on. And that leaves the last one of the turn, which is the Northern Islamic. Oops. Focus. Northern Islamic. And that's pretty much over here, the whites. So like I was discussing earlier, the main goal is to start getting your guys moving up the line so that you can eventually put pressure on Tashkent, hopefully, get them taken care of. Because we don't have, you know, you have to... put a leader in the Central Asia front or chooses one of your chits. I guess I could have used the Field Staff chit for that. Could have moved this guy. Maybe that's what we'll do. Yeah, that's what we'll do. One, two, three. So yeah, he'll come down here and start putting pressure. That's what we'll have done. That's smart. Okay. So we don't have a whole lot to work with up here, but we do have this guy. So he's going to go one, two, three. And the main goal of moving him up is to start to get to confront this guy, but also potentially put a part of, or put a garrison unit in Merv so that we can... Oh, although I have to put a garrison unit here as well. No, not necessarily, because holding Merv is the key, because then you can also get down here, so that's okay. We'll just keep him there. I only have one garrison unit for the Islamic whites, so I could put it in Ashgabat, but even if the red player draws the partisan units next turn and takes that, I still have access to Merv, so I'm not so worried about, you know, moving my garrison unit there right now. I'd rather save that one garrison unit and put him in Merv. All right, well, that was turn one. That would have gone a little faster had I not erroneously moved the Cossacks, but we can see what's going to happen there. And so we're done with that one. We look at the turn track, and we move to strategic turn A. What happens on strategic turns? Well, we look at our extended sequence of play, and we see that we determine first we're gonna let me go strategic turn. Oh wait, victory check here. No victory check. No one's auto won or anything. Allied withdrawal phase does not occur yet. That starts on. I guess I should be putting the camera on there. That doesn't occur until the beginning C. That's the first time you can actually start having allied withdrawal. So then we do the white reinforcement step. So the whites, as you can see, get this nice unit for the Armed Force South Russia. So it can be put in any city, I believe. Let's double check that rule. It's pretty easy to look up. Okay, units may be placed in enemy ZOC, but not enemy controlled city or enemy occupied hex. Stacking restrictions apply. If they have a hex, you put them in that hex. This one does not have a hex number on it. AFSR units in a white-controlled, non-red, non-red terror city that can trace supply to a Black Sea supply source. Okay, so yeah. Basically, it's you got to put in a city that's in supply. So I'll take this AFSR unit. He's going to come down here, and we could put him in here, I guess. It's totally viable. Put him in there. That's a good place. Armed Force South Russia unit can go there. He'll hang out with the Cossacks. Make friends with our Cossack buddies. And that'll give us a little bit more oomph down here. That's great. Unfortunately, the Reds also get their reinforcements here. So they get one, two, three, four more armies that are reduced. Let's see where the Reds have to put their reinforcements. Red units in a red-controlled city that can trace supply to Moscow. And stacking units apply. So essentially, I have to find cities that don't have red units in them, because remember, stacking requirement says I cannot put anything more than six in a unit, right? Unless I had the leader effect in a going on. So we come down here and we're like, oh, where could I put some red units? Well, Tambov could use one, and we definitely need some reinforcements in the south, so Tambov will get one. I could also put one in Voronezh. Runish, yeah. Put one there. I have two more remaining, so we should probably think about what's going on up here. I can't put one in Kazan, but I can put one in Nizhny Novgorod. No, why would I do that? We're going to put it here. Because the red train may get to help him out, possibly. Although we get to move the red train soon. Oh, he has to stay on a rail line, though. Nah, he's cool there. We'll keep that reduced army there. And then this next one, it's a big question. I could put it here in Nizhny, and that would help support here. Or I could put it in Vyatka and help reinforce this northern attack, which is not a half bad idea either. So I think we'll do that. I think we'll put it in there. Okay, so that's that. Make sure that is all we have to do. Oh, we're not going to do replacement steps. You skip that for that rule, right? So that's going to hurt the whites, but it also kind of helps us because the reds don't get to replace that one army that we managed to destroy. Probably could have maybe gotten more. Didn't really happen. Okay, so now we move on to turn two. And we roll to determine who has initiative. So let's do that real quick. It is a tie. Ugh, what is a tie? Great, now I have to look that up. All right. It probably just defaults to the one who had it last. Oh, re-roll the dice. Oh, okay, nice, okay. All right, the whites win that one 6-3, so it is a white turn. That means they get to select their first chit. We'll get to that in just a second, though. So now we'll do the random events phase. The non-initiative player gets to roll first, so the red's random event will be... Ooh, they roll a 12. Red leader. So another red leader comes into play. So we're going to put those in the cup. Mix up our red leaders. And... boom. Oh, Tukhachevsky, one of our best guys. So because we put, oh, I forgot we didn't have to even roll that die. I forgot we put a leader in the initiative in the field staff box. So that earlier roll means the reds get to go. That was my mistake. Totally forgot about that. Oops. So if you take a look, I put that leader here. So he gives us +1. I totally forgot about that. Sweet. That's good for us. So we won that initiative. Actually, the reds get to go first. That's big for us. All right. So we drew the red leader event. I guess that means we didn't get to roll then. Oh, so many consequences. Okay, so because the reds got to go first, the whites are the non-initiative player. So we'll roll for a white event first. Whites roll a 3. That is Typhus. Disorder one full-strength red infantry or cavalry unit of your choice. Ooh. That's actually kind of good. So I could weaken the unit in Tsaritsyn. That would have been great if I had the ability to really launch an attack on it, but I don't. So I think what we're going to do is we're just going to blunt this Siberian offensive. And I think we're just going to make this first army. You took Kazan. You took the gold. Now you got Typhus. Okay. It's actually a helpful white event that can be good. Not the best one, but it is helpful. All right, now we'll roll for the reds. They roll an 8. Ooh, a red terror. If available, place in any non-red city you control, except Krug's, White Supply Hexes, or cities in the Baltic Republics or Poland. The city is permanently treated as a red city for all purposes. Oh, that kind of makes me laugh. Portland is the red terror. This is devastating. This is good. This can turn any city into a red city that we control. Unfortunately, we don't control any really good cities. So we have a couple of good candidates. I could turn Nizhny Novgorod red, and that helps in case they get back, but that's looking less likely because I have a lot of forces here. So let's turn Perm. Let's turn Perm red. That way, if they ever come down here, this will be a constant weakness. They won't be able to really get defensive bonuses for holding it. So Perm now becomes a red city. All right, so I've done that. The Makhno allegiance phase would happen, but that doesn't start until we actually get them. And now we can move to strategic movement. And I think I'll take a break here because I'm going to think about what I want to do with strategic movement before we start really launching in turn two, but those are the events. So let's take a look at the board again. So down here in the south, the AFSR almost had two offenses if I'd have been more foolish that would have happened. Making progress down here and eventually going to move up. The Reds, of course, now have seized the gold. That was quite big for them, and they're going to keep pushing up here and moving the Siberians back. That's sort of the first priority, is sort of just keep pushing them back and containing them. And the Whites over here making some moves up there. Okay, so that's actually the first turn. Not a whole lot to do, but we're chugging through track. And we get inevitably closer to B, where a lot of the game-changing things happen, such as opening up down here, and some more units come in, the Baltics come into play. And things get a little bit hairier for the Whites and a little bit crazier for the Reds. So that'll be end of turn one. When we come back, turn two.